Hello everyone, welcome to our Sunday Online. Today we're coming at the harvest from a different angle, this time thinking about the seeds of what God is doing and growing into the amazing harvest of what is to come. So we begin with Psalm 147 verses 1-7. Praise the Lord! How good it is to sing praises to our God! How pleasant and fitting to praise Him! The Lord builds up Jerusalem. He gathers the exiles of Israel. He heals the brokenhearted and binds up their wounds. He determines the number of the stars and calls them each by name. Great is our Lord and mighty in power. His understanding has no limit. The Lord sustains the humble, but casts the wicked to the ground. Sing to the Lord with grateful praise. Make music to our God on the harp. So, let's do that. Praises to our God. How good it is to sing them. How good it is to listen to them. How pleasant, how fitting. That's what worship is, online, in person, walking along on your own, sitting in a room, singing to yourself, singing in the shower, wherever you do worship. That's what it is. Singing those pleasant and fitting praises to Him.
We say that there is no one like you, Jesus. We are here in your presence to worship you and to adore you. So let's sing this together.
Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Sing a new song to Him who sits on heaven's mercy seat. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Holy, holy is He. Sing a new song to Him who sits on heaven's mercy seat. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. With all creation I sing praise to the King of Kings. To worship you, Jesus.
this again. Filled with wonder, awestruck wonder at the mention of your name. Jesus, your name is power, breath and living water, such a marvelous mystery.
Jesus sends out the 72. After this, the Lord appointed 72 others and sent them two by two ahead of him, to every town and place where he was about to go. He told them, "The harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. Ask the Lord of the harvest, therefore, to send out workers into his harvest field. Go, I am sending you out like lambs among wolves. Do not take a purse or bag or sandals. Do not greet anyone on the road. When you enter a house, first say, 'Peace to this house.' If someone who promotes peace is there, your peace will rest on them. If not, it will return to you. Stay there, eating and drinking whatever they give you, for the worker deserves his wages. Do not move around from house to house. When you enter a town and are welcomed, eat what is offered to you. Heal those there who are ill and tell them the kingdom of God has come near to you. But when you enter a town and are not welcomed, go into its streets and say, 'Even the dust of your town we wipe from our feet as a warning to you. Yet be sure of this, the kingdom of God has come near.' I tell you, it will be more bearable for that day for Sodom than for that town." This is the word of the Lord. And what an encouraging word that is here. The harvest is plentiful. There is a plentiful harvest, but the workers are few. And our prayer is to the Lord of the harvest, Jesus, to send out workers into his harvest field. Let's pray that as we listen to Andy's message now. Lord, send out your workers into the harvest field.
Thank you. Hey everybody, it's great to be able to share with you today, whenever and wherever you are watching this. For those who don't know, I'm Andy, I'm the vicar here at St. Peter's and St. James. Well, I want to start my talk today just by kind of adding our thoughts and prayers of the whole of SBSJ to the family of Sir David Amos. Just such a tragedy that should happen. Somebody who's doing their job, who's making themselves available for those that they serve, and to be attacked in that way is sad. And the fact that this isn't the first time this has happened is deeply troubling. One of the reasons, of course, it's got so much attention because we know that in the last few years, over 250 people a year have died from a knife or a stab type wound. But this is, again, such a kind of publicity, if you like, because it's an attack on our freedom, it's an attack on our openness as a society. Now, we may kind of debate how open and transparent decisions are within our society, but compared to many countries around the world, it certainly is an open, transparent system that we have. And the alternative is for people to kind of retreat and go behind closed doors, and you can't get access to your MP anymore. And not just MPs, but it would soon follow suit with many other professions as well, worried about what might happen. We saw before in France the attack on the Catholic priest. So it's deeply troubling that this type of thing can happen. And it does kind of feel at the moment like we have a choice to make as a society. We have a choice of what type of society do we want? Do we want one that's just full of hatred and division that we see on social media all the time? Or do we want one like we hear in our gospel reading today, one of peace? Well, God sent his only son, Jesus, to proclaim peace. And as I say, Jesus, in our passage today, we see doing the same for his followers, to go out and proclaim peace. Note that word, sent. God sends his son, Jesus. Jesus sends the 72 in today's reading. Now, it's really important, that word sent, because the great theologian of mission, David Bosch, he tells us that mission is not something that belongs to us, but something that belongs to God, because mission is all about the calling back of the whole of creation back to God. It's all about healing and reconciliation. And so it's not something that's ours, it's something that's God. And so God sends his son in that ministry of healing and reconciliation, proclaiming peace. And then Jesus sends his followers to do that same ministry of healing and reconciliation, to proclaim peace. It's God's work, it's the work of the kingdom of God. But God invites us as co-heirs with Christ to partner in the work with him. So we can't do it without God. It is God's that we join in with. And as we know, this need for proclaiming peace is still so relevant for today and for our society and our culture today. What can we learn from today's gospel reading? And so I've just got a few things I kind of want to talk to you about running through today's passage. The first is to understand its urgency. In verse 1 of today's passage, it said this, that Jesus sent them out to go from town to town to the place where he was about to go. Now, Jesus is saying that because you remember the point where we are in the Gospels. Jesus has been at the mountain and he's heading now down all the way from the northern part of the kingdom. He's heading right down to Jerusalem, and he knows what's going to happen when he gets to Jerusalem. He knows that that's the end of his earthly ministry in human form, and so he knows there's no time to waste. So rather than waiting to get to each town to do ministry, he sends out his followers two by two to go to each town and place, and to go on ahead of him, to prepare the way for him in that kind of John the Baptist style way, so that when he arrives, there's already people who've been prepared, ready to hear and receive Jesus for themselves. So there's this kind of urgency. Jesus knows this is it. This is their last chance to turn to him before he dies on that cross, and then before the Romans come along later on and just ransack Israel and drive people out. So there's an urgency. And there's a, this is kind of a, what's interesting is we often wonder, why is it 72? Well, there's a link. Jesus is often kind of referred back to kind of being like Moses. And we have the same in the story today. So Jesus, if you kind of think back, one of the things Moses did obviously was help people escape from Egypt. And then they spend this kind of time in Exodus in the desert before reaching the promised land eventually. And Moses leads the people through that time. But while they're in the desert, while they're in that kind of place of Exodus, they are wandering around, they're hungry, they're confused, they're wondering where the promised land is, and they start complaining to God. And so they complain to God though through Moses, and Moses kind of cries out to God, and God provides this manna from heaven. And you can read about that in Numbers chapter 11. And then after the manna from heaven falls down and they just gather up this plenty of food, we read this in Numbers chapter 11, verse 16. It said, "The Lord said to Moses, 'Bring me 70 of Israel's elders who are known to you as leaders and officials among the people. Have them come to the tent of meeting that they may stand there with you. I will come down and speak with you there, and I will take some of the power of the Spirit that is on you and put it on them. They will share the burden of the people with you so that you will not have to carry it alone. Tell the people, consecrate yourselves in preparation for tomorrow when you will eat meat. The Lord heard you when you wailed. If only we had meat to eat, we were better off in Egypt. Now the Lord will give you meat and you will eat it.'" And it goes on with the story. Now, what's interesting about that, you see, in that moment of complaining, the people were saying we were better off in Egypt. There was this temptation to turn away from God again and to go back into slavery. And instead, God says, no, 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 don't do that. I'm going to provide for you. I'm going to give you everything you need. You need to trust in me. And to help Moses in his task in leading that community to the promised land, God says, choose 70 people, and I'm going to bless them. I'm going to take some of the Spirit, Holy Spirit, off you, Moses, and I'm going to give it to them to help you in leading the people back to the promised land. And there's a couple of others as well who kind of receive the benefit of that blessing, which is why we have 72 in today's passage. It's replicating that story from the Old Testament, from when they were in the desert place, and they had this clear choice to make. Do we carry on and push on to the promised land, or do we go back to being kind of bound and enslaved in the ways of the world like we were before? So what we're seeing here is Jesus doing exactly the same as Moses did. The Spirit that had been on Jesus, he is now empowering his followers, these 72 people that he chooses, to go out and to proclaim the peace, to encourage them to keep pushing on to the kingdom, the promised land of God. So it's important to kind of understand this historical context that we're in, this sense of urgency that this could be your last chance. So don't miss out. And our job is to prepare people ready for Jesus' return. So that's the first thing, understanding the urgency and this kind of historical context of the passage, linking back to Moses and the desert place. The second thing is to be expectant, to know that the harvest is plentiful. Let me read verse 2 to you again. It says, he told them, "The harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. Ask the Lord of the harvest, therefore, to send out workers into his harvest field." It says the harvest is plentiful. Now, how often in church, I mean, in Hereford, we know the stats are something like 1% of people actually in the city actually go to church on a Sunday. 1%. You know, and we kind of just see stats like that and we just fall into this trap of thinking people aren't interested anymore. But the Bible says the harvest is plentiful. People still want to know about this peace that God alone can provide. They still want to know about the love of God. They need the love of God in their lives. So be expecting that people will and want to respond to God's message. The third thing then, verse 3, it goes on to say, doesn't it, kind of how to do that. So go, I'm sending you out like lambs among wolves. Strange phrase, isn't it? But what it's saying is, look, the way we do things is different to the way the world does it. Now it's interesting then, kind of this word evangelism that kicks in. See, if you look on Wikipedia, which is of course just put together by people can just type any page into Wikipedia. It will say this: in Christianity, evangelism or witnessing is the act of preaching the gospel with the intention of sharing the message and the teachings of Jesus Christ. So it becomes all about kind of proclaiming with words. But interestingly, if you look at the dictionary definition of evangelism, then it says the spreading of the Christian gospel by public preaching or personal witness. It goes beyond just what we do with our words. Now, one of the reasons that you get these kind of different versions and people have these different views of what evangelism is because the word's actually quite hard to translate from the original Greek, because it doesn't occur much outside the New Testament. But what we do know is it is all about proclaiming the good news. The difficulty comes in again, kind of say, how do we do that? Now, don't forget what James says in his letter, that it's about word and deed. If we just proclaim with our words, then we might have short-term success. But actually what people generally find quite quickly is that our words don't match our actions. We've got to proclaim with our deeds, with our actions, as well as our words. And we've been hearing all about that, haven't we? Been challenged by that with Climate Sunday from Andy last week, from Luke 2 weeks ago, the example of St. Francis. Before that, obviously celebrating the harvest that had come in. So our deeds, our actions are really important when it comes to evangelism. We've got to kind of set that example, and through doing that, it enables the opportunity to share with our words. The fourth thing I want to quickly say is to be focused. Look at verse 4 again. Do not take a purse or a bag or sandals, and do not greet anyone on the road. Now, it's saying that because it's saying don't get distracted. Again, remember 2 weeks ago, Luke saying about how he was always surprised when he chatted to monks and nuns that they talk about thinking they'd be devastated, all this stuff they had to give up and what a big burden it was. He said, no, it's the opposite. They feel free, free from the ways of the world. Don't be distracted by this world. Don't be distracted. There's much that can worry us, that can trouble us. But that's why the Bible says time and time again, don't worry about these things. God knows what you need. God will provide for you. Like we saw in the desert, the manna that falls from heaven. God will provide. Don't worry about those things. Focus on the kingdom of God. Don't be distracted. Focus. Then the fifth thing is just to remember that it is all about joining in with what God is already doing. Now, because of that, it means that we may have ideas at times, but don't assume. Be open to the Spirit. Be open to things not being exactly like we thought they were going to be like. I mean, when I think about my past, I just think how amazing it's been, the huge variety of things I've been able to be involved in. When I was in Warsaw, I was able to put on youth events, having had no experience of working with young people. That led to me being in a band that kind of got to go around the country, and we just loved just encouraging young people to go for it and to think how they can reach out to other young people as well. Then when I was in West Brom, I got to be a chaplain for the YMCA, and I was just shocked at just how many 18-year-olds would turn up with just a black bag. And that's all the possessions they had in the world. I never thought that would happen in this country. Whilst also in my time in West Brom, I got to put on this big art exhibition, a commission and art exhibition, which was seen by 10,000 people. I don't have a creative, artistic bone in my body, and yet I was able to be involved in that project. Then, of course, the call to ordination. And now, having been involved in some amazing things here, like leading the Remembrance Sunday Parade again for thousands of people, it just still boggles me that I'm privileged to do that for the city. But now we have also the SBS Joe project, which you should have had an invitation to. Just to explain, because I know it's been a long time, the pandemic has made our brains a little bit fuzzy, but back in February last year, for those who've been with us for a while, we had a whole church meeting, which we set out what this project was that we were applying for money for from the diocese to back us on this. Their pot of money was called the Total Returns Funding. That might sound familiar to you. Well, this is the project that, in a sense, has come out of that. So it's all about reaching younger generations with the message of Christ's love and peace. So we're working, we want to do more work. I spent years kind of finding these people of peace that today's passage talked about, and I found lots of them in our city. And so we're going to be working even closer with our two primary schools, with St. James and St. Thomas Canterlury. We're going to be working, we're going to be providing a chaplaincy service for NMIT, which Andy's already started and doing a great job on. You know, we're also in conversations with the colleges as well of Hereford, and we're providing that well-being support to the staff and the students who are really struggling at this time of uncertainty still. Then also part of the project is we're reimagining what city ministry looks like to the heart of our city. St. Peter's in this amazing location, it's this beautiful church. So how can we get the doors open and just serve the needs of our city in new ways? And again, we're working with some of the businesses in the city as well as to how we can support them in what they do. You know, Jeremiah talks about just praying for the prosperity of our city, because if it prospers, we prosper too. And so we know this is a partnership thing. We don't stand alone in the church, and we want to work with our city, work with all of our partners, the city council, the colleges, the university, our primary schools, venture, all of these organisations. We want to work with them and just work together for the good of the kingdom of God. So lots going on there in the future. If you want to get involved in any of that, please do get in touch. Or if you want to know more of that, we're thinking of putting on a special evening that people could come along to. So to kind of just finish off, really, I just want to say, let us just expect God to move. Let's believe that God wants his church to grow in Hereford. And may we remember that it happens through us, through our actions as well as our words. And not to get distracted, but to stay focused on God's kingdom. And let's be ready to join in with what God is already doing and what God is going to do. You know, God told the Israelites in the desert to consecrate themselves, to be ready for God moving. Well, let us consecrate ourselves. And we do that today through prayer and through worship, presenting ourselves as a living sacrifice to God, allowing the Holy Spirit to come into our lives and to use us for the glory of God. Amen.
Let the King of my heart be the mountain where I run, the fountain I drink from, oh, he is much. Let the King of my heart be the shadow where I hide, the ransom for my life, oh, he is much. 'Cause you are good. Good. Oh, you are good, so good. Oh, you are good, good. Oh, you are good, so good. Oh, let the King of my heart my sails, the anchor in the waves, oh, he is mine. Let the King of my heart be the fire inside my veins, the echo of my days, oh, he is mine. Let the King of my heart be the wind inside my sails, the anchor in the waves, oh, he is mine. Let the King of my heart be the fire inside my veins, the echo of my days, oh, he is my soul. 'Cause you are you are. you're never gonna let me down. And you're never gonna let, you're never gonna let me down. You're never gonna let, you're never gonna let me down. You're never gonna let, you're never gonna let me down. You're never gonna let, you're never gonna let me down. You're never gonna let, you're never gonna let me down. You're never gonna let, you're never gonna let me down. Cause you are.
Andy, for that message, such an encouragement that there is a great harvest, and we pray to the Lord to send out people. Who are those people who are sent out to the work, to be workers in the harvest field? That's you, that's me, that's every single believer, workers in the harvest field. How can we be workers in the harvest field today? Now, Andy mentioned the SBSJ project, and I wanted to mention about the launch of that. That's coming up on Sunday the 7th of November at 2 to 3pm, and you would be very welcome at that. The link to the Eventbrite is just on the screen now. If you go to that, you'll be able to sign up. I just wanted to show you the introductory video to what this is all about, the SBSJ project, reaching out to next generations with the love of Christ. So check out this video made for us by Adam at the Diocese. It's amazing and really gets a bit of a flavour about what this is about.
Hereford, a city of history, known for its cattle, cider, the SAS and the home of the Mapamundi. Hereford captures the rural features of the area that surrounds it. For 930 years, St Peter's Church has been a beacon in the Hereford skyline. The church has seen the city grow into the place it has become now, and continues to serve and support the surrounding area. This new decade has posed unique challenges, and we are seeking to show the love of God to all using new pioneering approaches to ministry. This autumn, the parish of St Peter's and St James is launching a project to breathe new life into the city. The SPSJ project aims to reach out to students and young adults and grow a community where they can find their own faith in Jesus, expressed in a way that is real and authentic for them. We long to reimagine church in our city centre in a way that reaches those who have never even considered joining any church before. Part of this work will include working alongside local schools, colleges and businesses to be a constant supportive, encouraging presence in both a chaplaincy and community context. The SPSJ project will be identifying and responding to the recent shifts in the city's landscape, especially the increase of online interaction and growing isolation and loneliness that has occurred from the pandemic. The younger generation is hurting, and we want to offer them a place of hope, safety and love, inspired by the wonderful love of Jesus. Who knows where the Lord will take us next? Come and join us as we take the first steps on this journey.
So you'd be so welcome at that on Sunday the 7th of November, 2 to 3pm. Bishop Rich is going to be commissioning the whole team and we're going to hear from people who have been impacted and people who have supported us. So we'd love to see you there. Another thing that's coming up is the light party on Halloween night on the 31st. Details for that on the screen now. If you know any families who would be interested, please just pass that message around. We really rely on word of mouth for these sort of things. So please, you'd be very welcome to come with your children, or please pass it around to people you know in the area who might be interested. We'd love to connect to new people for that. It's such a good opportunity to reach out, as it's one of the only occasions when you have people just wandering around the place. And we'd love to reach out to some of those families in a new way. And finally, one last thing is the Kintsugi Hope groups, the wellbeing groups. They're starting on the 8th of November. If you are interested in possibly considering being part of that, send a message to our office email, office@spsj.org.uk, and we can give you some more information about that. So thanks so much for being with us, and let's pray together that the Lord of the harvest would send out his workers into the harvest field. And Lord, we pray, we thank you that you are the Lord of the harvest. We thank you that there is a great harvest to come, even in this nation, even when things seem so small right now, even when your church seems like such a small force, like the 1% or less people following you, even when the 99% may seem so distant. Lord, we cry to you for the harvest, and we pray to you as you asked us to, as you said that we should. We pray to you, Lord, to send out workers into the harvest field. And I pray for all those who are listening now, that you would show them how they are to be workers in your harvest field. We thank you for the harvest that is to come. We thank you that all of us are part of your harvest. We thank you that you call us to be workers in your harvest field. And we praise you in faith for the harvest that is to come. Lord, let it be so. Let there be a great harvest of people coming to know and worship you in this nation. In Jesus' name, amen.
How I long to breathe the air of heaven, where pain is gone and mercy fills the streets, to look upon the one who bled to save me and walk with him for all eternity. There will be a day when all will bow before him. There will be a day when death will be no more. Standing face to face with he who died and rose again. Holy, holy is the Lord. And every prayer we prayed in desperation, the songs of faith we sang through doubt and fear, in the end we'll see that it was worth it when he returns to wipe away our tears. A thousand generations. sing, worthy is the Lamb who was slain. And on that day, we join the resurrection and stand beside the heroes of the faith, with one voice, a thousand generations sing, worthy is the Lamb who was slain.